Hey guys, welcome to my guide of how to speedrun LEGO Indiana Jones The Original Adventures. I've been speedrunning this game for about 6 months now and currently hold the 80% co-op world record, the Raiders of the Lost Ark co-op world record, as well as several individual level co-op world records. In this guide, I'm going to be showing you some of the basic techniques used in the run, as well as show and explain some of the more difficult skips in the game that are harder to work out than just watching the run itself. I'm only going to show the solo strats in this video, but if you're interested in co-op, then you can go away because that's my category. You can join the Discord, ask me or Louis, we'll help you out. We need competition in that category. No one else runs it, so please join us, please. I'll convince you more later, but first of all, let's talk about the Discord. If you aren't part of it already, it's just in the description, just one click and you're in. That's it. All the active runners are in there all the time, every day, talking about the game and the run. So if you have any questions, just ask them. We're not all knowledgeable, so sometimes I have questions, sometimes other people have questions, and we all just contribute to each other. It's a great way to learn the game and learn the run, so I definitely recommend it. Get the Discord server, it'll help you out massively, definitely help me out massively. But before we get onto the actual techniques, we need to talk about the different categories you can actually run, so you can work out what you want to do when you start running this game. So if you want to run the game, you need to know what different runs there are. First, there's the obvious ones, like any percent, where you complete all of the story levels as fast as possible in any order. 100%, where you get 100% completion in the game as fast as you can. All artifacts, which is where you collect all 180 artifacts in the game as fast as you can. And free play percent, where you complete every level in free play as fast as you can. Each category has its own individual strats and routes, so I may not explain these in the video, but that's exactly where the Discord comes in. There's also some other categories like Star Wars, where you find all the Star Wars characters, and film runs, where you complete all 6 levels in a film in any order as fast as you can. And finally, there's individual level runs. This is very self-explanatory and where I started, and I recommend others to start. Even if you don't get the record, it allows you to practice the individual skips, so I would start there before you go into full film or game runs. If you want to find the timings for these runs, all you have to do is go to the speedrun.com page for the run you want, click on the rules, and it tells you when to start and stop the timer. And finally, let's get on to the basics. As LEGO Indiana Jones was one of the early LEGO games, there aren't really any complicated mechanics or abilities you need to know for the speedrun, and if you've played the game casually at any point in your life, you probably know everything you need to know. But if you haven't, then that's okay, because you can just watch the run and that'll basically teach you everything that you need to know. I recommend you run this game on controller, as some of the jumps require an angle not easily captured on WASD. It's not impossible, but may slow you down or cause you to use other strats. Some good runs have been submitted on keyboard though, so don't give up if you don't have a controller. It's just what I recommend. Feel free to use your keyboard as your second controller, which I'll talk about in a moment. For settings, try and play as low settings as much as you can, with VSync turned on by default, as this can cause you to miss some jumps. Settings don't affect loading times very much, so unless you're fighting for seconds, they aren't super important. This game is from 2008, so any good PC built in the last 5 years or so will get fast enough loading times that it won't affect your splits much. As I run co-op, I don't really have to deal with this, but I'm going to go through it anyway. At multiple points in the game, there are puzzles or skips that require both players to be active at the same time. This can range from anything between half a second to 30 seconds. If you haven't run games which require 2 players before, then this might put you off, but trust me, it's not very frequently used, and the moves are never really complicated. If this does put you off a little bit, however, then I have to recommend you find a friend who wants to run the game with you, and you can use Remote Player, which I'll show on the screen right now. It's very easy, and they don't even have to buy the game. You can just invite them. Any of your friends can play with you. It's a really cool feature, and not enough people use it. I know I'm kind of biased, but co-op is really a great category, and I think more people should run it, honestly. And if you don't have any friends, I'm sure you're used to using your other hand to play with yourself. Anyway, moving on. If you've watched the run up to 1-4, you may be confused, and trust me, I was too. If you have no idea what a transition is, it's essentially a 2D plane of the level, which allows you to move to the next part of that level. And if you didn't know what a skip is, you probably shouldn't be a speedrunner. Anyway, in a few of the levels, there's a way to use these transitions to get out of bounds, and then you can get to a different transition before you're supposed to. The first thing to know is that the way to make a transition skip 1,000 times easier is that this is the one time in the run that you turn off VSync. You turn it off just before you do it and turn it back on after you've done it. These skips aren't exactly intuitive, so take your time to practice them, and trust me, you'll get it very quickly. It's not that hard to learn, just do it a couple of times and then you'll be getting it almost every time. So the way to do this type of glitch is by punching player 2, who's dropped out, directly into the room transition in a certain spot so that they're pressed up against it. And after you hit them the 4th time, walk very slightly towards them but not enough to trigger the transition, and then you can push them through the wall, The way to tell is if they move and you don't. If you move and they don't, that means it didn't work. In order to get this right, just watch this back a few times, watch the run a couple of times to see the spots, and if you do it correctly, it should take them out of bounds. So, let's talk about out of bounds. In around half the levels in the game, you'll probably find yourself out of bounds, and even though it is an endless void with countless hazards, it's not that scary. Out of bounds works slightly differently, but the way you walk around is very simple. Essentially, the out of bounds area consists of lots and lots of invisible platforms at varying levels of height, below and around the room itself. As long as you keep walking, you'll continue to stay on the layer you're on until you reach the edge of the platform, at which point you'll fall off, obviously. If you want to go up a layer or two, all you have to do is jump and you'll go through the layers above you, and eventually you'll land on one of them. If you want to go down, stop moving for a little bit or drop you until you continue to move again. If you want to go down just a little bit, a little trick you can use is if you punch while moving, it will drop you down for the duration of the punch animation, and then you can just continue to walk on the lower platform. That's really all you need to know about out of bounds, so moving on. There's a weird quirk with VSync, but when it's turned on, you're able to dig and fix really quickly. All that's required is you have to spam the action button, B for Xbox and Circle for PlayStation, as fast as you can. That's it, it's that simple. It doesn't work with building because of how the game tracks building progress, but make sure you use it for the other ones. This technique is used a couple of times in the run, and if you get it wrong, it can cause a massive time loss and can probably kill your run, so make sure you have to get this right. So the box duplication is achieved by picking up a box with a character with a slow pickup animation. These characters are the three girl characters, and also Henry Jones. The actual duplication itself is done by swapping to another character while the animation is playing, and this will cause the character to stand in place with a box in their hands. Then all you have to do is push them around a bit so they line up with the green square, pick up the box with the other character, and they'll throw it right in front of them, and then you can just drop the box down and do it again, or put it on the other green square if it's only two. You may have to do it only once like that in 2-1 Shanghai Showdown, or three times in 3-1 The Hunt for Sir Richard. It's a very easy technique, but it causes so much time loss if you get it wrong, but I'm sure you'll pick it up very quickly and it won't cause you too much trouble. Since we're talking about duplicating, I'm going to slide this in here. You can actually duplicate officer hats and turbans by both characters picking them up at the same time. This isn't used anywhere in the run directly, but if you want a nice backup or if you're running co-op, it's quite useful and it's good to know. Next up is tag moving. So in a few levels, after completing an action as part of a puzzle, the camera may lock to a certain position to show something happening. And in some cases, you can actually repeatedly tag or swap between characters to move while this plays. There's two ways this can be done. Yeah, you can do it with one player, with two playable characters like in 2-3 Temple of Kali, or with player 2 swapping and player 1 moving in levels with 3 characters like in 2-4. Don't do it too fast or it won't work, and to understand a decent rhythm, watch the gameplay in this segment and watch the top corners to see how often I switch. This is another really easy technique, so I'm sure you'll pick it up instantly, but it can save you a bunch of seconds over the course of the run, so it's heavily worth doing because you can do it about 5 or so times during the run. It's pretty cool. So if you are thinking of running this game, I hope this guide covered everything you needed it to. If I did miss something, make sure to flame me in the comments and join the Discord where you can ask questions. It's where all the strats and all the runs are discussed and discovered, so it's a really cool place to join. Very soon I'm going to start making some speedrun level walkthroughs, so I go through each of the levels in the game and go through all the strats and explain how to do them. So if you're interested in that, make sure you subscribe so you don't miss any of them. And if any of those strats become obsolete, I'll make updates, so make sure you don't miss any of them and any world records I get in the future. So smash that subscribe button, it'd be greatly appreciated. And also leave a like on this video if you thought it was helpful. If you want to see a video explaining some of the techniques involved in other runs of this game, then let me know and I'll see what I can do. I'm not an expert in any of the other categories, but if I can try and ask around, I can maybe make a comprehensive guide for those other runs as well. This video took me ages. You might have noticed I've changed shirts a couple of times in the video, just explained how long this one took. I hope you enjoyed it though. I put a lot of effort in and a lot of time, so I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you on the next one. Bye.